talking about risk and prevention this week. And we're going to approach this from several different kinds of directions. Let's start by, talking again about the Janane quadruplets. Remember that these are identical quadruplets, all sharing the same genes, and yet they didn't develop schizophrenia to the same degree, some much more severe than others. And our question this week is why? So one way of thinking about this is from the diathesis stress model, that there is some sort of vulnerability, this diathesis, and that can either be biological or psychological, and that stressors or life events may, if severe enough, move someone over the threshold and they develop the disorder. So for example, because person one has a fairly high diathesis, develops alcoholism, whereas person two with the same amount of stress does not. Carney and Troll talk about diathesis not just in terms of this biological underpinning, but in terms of psychological states. So for example, if we're looking at people who are high, medium, or low in terms of impulsivity, with the same amount of stress, people at high levels of impulsivity are much more likely to develop alcoholism. If we take this back to the Janane quadruplets, what I would suggest is happening is in part that they are not exposed to the same degree of stressors. In fact, we know that the father targeted some of the daughters more than others, and that perhaps over their lifetime they developed greater or lesser psychological resources. Now, let's think about this in terms of trauma, and we'll talk more about this later in the semester. But one of the things that we know about trauma is that almost everyone who is raped, and these data are from women who've been raped, almost everyone develops PTSD symptoms. And yet, 3 months out, probably less than half. And so our question again is, what's different? What's different? And if we know something about what's different, then we can do something to help them become more resilient. So as we're thinking about disorders this semester, we should be thinking about what increases our risk and what decreases our risk. So, we might think, for example, in terms of the Janane quadruplets, one of the things that seem to separate them or distinguish them is the amount of abuse that some of the daughters experienced in this fairly unstable kind of household. And think about what things increase your risk. Certainly stress. Certainly not getting good sleep, not eating well. Substance abuse. Those are all risk factors. But we can also do things that decrease risk. So this is sort of a variation from the diathesis stress model. There are factors that increase risk, but also factors that decrease risk. So social support, spirituality, sleep, an optimistic worldview, all decrease risk. I'm only going to talk briefly about the figures here. You can find them in your book. Certainly, we want to be paying attention to the risk factors in the left column, but I'd also want you to be thinking in terms of what that means. So for example, with marital status, probably what you know, what is happening is that people who are divorced have less social support. And one of the things we'll find throughout the semester is that social support seems to be predictive of status. We can also think in terms of education and employment, is that probably people with less education or who are unemployed are exposed to more stressors, have fewer social resources and finances in order to handle stressors well. I'm really interested in what is, you know, what will help us to do well. And we can think about three different kinds of things that serve as protective factors. Individual protective factors include things like optimism and intelligence and social skills and spirituality. Family factors include having a small, supportive family where parents are adequately monitoring their children and setting appropriate rules for them. And where the community is committed to helping its citizens do well. So investing in schools, making health and social services available, really being supportive of each other. And these are obviously things that some communities do better than others. I'm going to, throughout the semester, talk about what things you can do to handle stress better. And one of the things that I would recommend is that you, you know, learn and use strategies that will help you become more optimistic. Use active coping when appropriate, you know, so if you can, if you have a problem to solve, do it. Build your social support system. Develop your faith. If you have, you know, if that's an important part of your life, there are also obviously a variety of different faith things or supports that you can do. And develop a meaningful story. Having a story that is meaningful, you know, a meaningful life story that provides a positive way of looking at things can be very helpful. Another way that we can look at things is in terms of prevalence. So we're going to be, in this next little bit, talking about epidemiology. And one of the things we're going to do is think about when and where are these, you know, is a diagnosis found? This is a map from the Centers for Disease Control. And you'll notice that there are higher levels of depression in the South. And our question as psychologists should be, what's different? What's going on here? Now, this research is a kind of naturalistic observation. We'll talk more, or you'll see more about that in Chapter 4. And one of the difficulties here, or one of the good things here, is that there are a variety of confounds. And so we have to sort of tease apart the data to try and figure out what's happening here. What's happening in Texas or Louisiana that isn't happening in Wisconsin and Minnesota, for example? If we look at prevalence, sometimes what we're going to be doing is thinking about when and where are we seeing problems and to what degree. So, for example, you see here that most anxiety disorders, or the majority of anxiety disorders, are relatively mild, whereas mood disorders are more likely to be severe. So we can begin to use those data to make some predictions about where and how we might want to intervene. Here we're thinking about issues of comorbidity. And what I would do is look at just the pink bars, and you notice that with three or more disorders, almost half of people with three or more disorders have a serious problem. Whereas more than half of people with only one disorder have a mild disorder. If we were working in a school, for example, a grade school, we might be, you know, one of the questions we might ask is, when do people have, or what kinds of issues are most likely to appear at, you know, in this setting? And the average age of onset for anxiety disorders is 10. So we might want to intervene at that point to do some things to prevent development of an anxiety disorder. Certainly in a college setting, we're going to be more likely to be thinking about what can we do to prevent substance abuse. We also, in a college setting, are going to be pretty interested in what happens that first semester when many students run into problems with homesickness and depression. On this chart, pay attention to the pink bars and to the orange bars. And you'll notice that people in their 20s are much more likely to develop disorders of any of these types than are their grandparents, you know, people in their 60s and 70s. And so, again, part of what these data do is allow us to begin to frame questions so we know how to intervene and we can begin to make some recommendations. I said we were going to talk about prevention today. And we were thinking in terms of how we might enter the school and prevent problems. So, you know, we might be saying, you know, here are, we're concerned about anxiety in our grade school. What can we do to prevent it? And that's a kind of primary prevention. Secondary prevention is when we're recognizing that there is a problem already and we're trying to do what we can to prevent it. So if we go back to the resilience data presented by FOA et al., or by Rothbaum et al., what we're seeing is perhaps an opportunity to intervene relatively early to prevent problems. And tertiary problems or prevention is a way of intervening to prevent or to help maintain problems or maintain positive functioning. So with the Janane quadruplets, once they were already showing symptoms of schizophrenia, you know, early 20s, perhaps intervening in some way to help stabilize them and prevent the symptoms from getting worse. So some strategies for ending as we're thinking about prevention. In general, we have waited until there's a problem, and then we do something. And I think in general, what we want to be doing is focusing more on prevention and focusing more on keeping the person stable in the future. And frankly, in terms of our using our resources well, this is probably the most effective strategy. So, what should you do now? Think about what you do well and what factors support your success. When do you struggle and what could you do to handle stress better? Later this semester, I'm going to ask you to consider what you can do to prevent psychiatric problems. And third, find a figure outlining where or when psychiatric disorders occur and what recommendations would you draw.